Ja, morgongymnastik.
Och den håller Hasse i här. Och sen klockan 8 så är det då frukost.
Ni får duscha, men då får ni duscha snabbt för det blir bara ont om vatten nu.
Ja, och när ni har duschat och så har vi då matlag. Vi har samma matlag.
Jag vet om att jag såg dig spela på flera möten 68-69.
Sen delar vi in oss i diskussionsgrupper.
Kommer diskutera passiv motstånd.
Ja, och det är viktigt nu, va?
Jag skojar.
Vi
gör
det,
va? Jag såg den här gången på Q också när du gick av scenen för det var någon skivbolags snubbe hade bett dig inte spela politik och sånt.
Ja, på sen eftermiddag kommer vi ha ett band som heter Röda Ropet.
Hur gammal är du egentligen?
De kommer hit för att de
stöder oss nu. Och det är också
Femta. Jag tyckte du var suverän. Jag diggar dig. Du gick av senare, jag tyckte det var idiotiskt.
Varför tyckte du det?
Alkoholskadade som vistas i huset dag och kvällstid.
Ja, det var ju sant det han sa.
Störda ungdomar.
Alla var ju bara där för att höra dina kärlekssånger.
Och de har bara tre
hälsen, skriver han. Jag är kommunist och för mig så får musiken inte bli ett självändamål.
Det låter som en grammofonspelare.
Blanda sig med tvåan och trean, gubbarna och de oroliga här, skriver han.
Jag vet inte vad jag ska säga. Jag fattar inte hur ensam jag är. Jävla ensamhet. Jag skäms. Jag har gått oförlåtligt.
Hej, kan vi komma in en stund?
Den här killen sitter på mycket.
Våldtog en 7-åring när han var 19.
Jag ringer för att du inte ska fortsätta med alla misstänkta.
Jag tror inte det var han som mördade Helene.
Du har aldrig pratat med mig.
Hög arbetslöshet, missbruk.
Pervon och pedofiler i varenda buske.
Helene låg med huvudet ut mot vägen. Jannica med huvudet ut mot Hässleholm.
Det har gått 14 år sedan mordet och vi har ingen gärningsman.
Ni har 6 veckor på er.
Du springer omkring och förstör organisationen. Det kan inte tolereras.
Jag gjorde ju ett bra jobb.
Jag har aldrig gjort något bra tidigare.
Jag ångrar mig så in i helvete.
Han är helt nära. Ändå hittar vi inte den djävulen.
Oförlåtligt.
Hi, this is James Velasquez, and welcome to the Masterclass for Directors, presented by Kultur Akademin. Today we'll be speaking to Mikael Marsaman.
Welcome, Mikael.
Thank you.
Can you just give the audience a little background? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, born in Stockholm in 1970, went to a French private school. After that, did some small jobs here and there, in the record store, for example, and then I started studying I think stills photography, and then I went to film school, Stockholm's film school, and also studied for 1.5 years, I think, or 2, film history.
Music plays an important role in all your projects, regardless of the subject matter.
Yeah.
It's almost a part of your process.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Can you explain how you use music both during the developing stages, shooting stages, and finally in the post-process?
Yeah. Often when I read a script, or if I get a script sent to me, I would read it once, but I would also read it, maybe not the first time, but definitely the second time. I'd listen to music while reading it. Sometimes there's music in the script that you want to listen to, and I think music actually is so important because it's, for me at least, it's a very emotional thing. I think music can make all the difference, but it's also how to not put music on things. Sometimes you have to go there and know when to shut up or when to be silent or when not to play the notes, to refer to Miles Davis. Yeah. It's also the notes that you don't play. I think for me it's a way of getting into the start process and the script and the development. It's about getting into the things, and sometimes it could be related to the period, and sometimes it could be related to a certain feeling of a character or a certain feeling of a scene. I'm listening a lot to music. So it's a big part of my life, and I don't think I should, I could take it away from the process of making series or films.
Do you assign songs to characters, or do you find themes for
characters? Yeah, yes, songs, definitely songs. I mean, you and I know that we worked together on a project called Up to Camp, and I don't know if you remember, we had that special song called The Colorado, I think, that we had for the journey of the character Tommy, Sverre play.
Har du varit någonstans?
Jag tror att göra en grej.
Vad för grej?
Det är bara en grej. Vad fick du för tavlan?
Alltså, vi klarar oss.
I've been working a lot with Mattias Berghed, who has composed basically everything I've done since Up to Camp. We have a very close relationship, and he also works from the script. He also starts his process reading the script and then just starts writing before he even had seen one single frame of what we shot. And in the best case scenarios, these are not finished songs or finished themes, but they could influence you how you shoot a scene as well. I mean, it could refer to Sergio Leone, who asked Ennio Morricone to write his music. He was actually designed camera moves to the music of Ennio Morricone in some films, like Once Upon a Time in the West or what have you. So the music was made before. I mean, that's not really where we are with Matthias as a composer, but we definitely have sketches or demos that we sometimes could even use during shoot, before even going into final editing, before even going into final mix with music and everything. And I mean, sometimes they're used, sometimes they're not, but the music is very important for me as how I myself gonna get into a scene. I can use it with actors, I can use it for camera moves and speed of the camera moves, even though I remove it later, it defines something within the work we're doing. It's like a dance, it's like a composing, you know, a piece. So sometimes you would choose to really cover a scene, but sometimes, which I love is to do, is to not overcover a scene, but to let, you know, the room and the characters define the situation, maybe in one long shot, and it could be a tracking shot or whatever, going from a character to another, picking it up, hearing sound off camera. It's also a way to make it feel real and to make you feel in the room, but it's also, as an audience, but it's also a way of creating, for me, tension in a specific scene, not to see everything like a dialogue scene, for example. You could do it easy and just do, you know, over the shoulder, close up, you know, medium wide, cover it. But sometimes the strength of cinema or TV is to just hang on there and not see everything, but to maybe hear and you want to see things, and then you get to see them, maybe. You know what I mean? Mm. It's like one very interesting thing that Roman Polanski actually said, I think, was, I don't know if it's okay to mention him.
Sure.
But cinematically interesting was, I think it was Rosemary's Baby, when he has a camera shot through a doorway and you don't really see what's going on in there. And you go as an audience, you go like, oh, I wanna peek in there. So it's about creating tension of making people wanting to still keep looking and finding out what's gonna happen in the shot or in the scene or in the film.
Yeah, I think a perfect example of that, and maybe you can talk about it, is the long shot from the dressing room onto stage to a live performance in Up to Camp on the first day of shooting.
Yeah,
or the second day
that, that was tough.
Välkomna till Q-Club.
Tom, är du klar?
Kan jag gå på den?
Kom igen nu.
Vi vill gå på.
kommer se både tjej och Jack Evans skickar. Men kvinnor så gäller det väl en stor tjej. Men nu mina damer och herrar, alla får för Tommy and the Heartbreaker!
Specifically about that shot or that scene in Up to Camp, it was introducing the audience to a new world, the club owner, we follow him in. And I wanted to like drag, I mean, what I've privately as a music interested person or a person that's been to a lot of concerts and, you know, been impressed with certain bands or groups or, you know, artists, you want to know what's going on back, you know, in the back, you know, you always want to go backstage, you know. So just the tension of, you know, for the audience to, you know, present, okay, this is the room where the show is going to take place, but this is what's going to happen before the show, or maybe after the show, and what you don't yet get to see on stage. It was an idea how to introduce, basically, what was behind the scenes and introduce the main character, Tommy.
And the music was played live. That was yep. What was, I think, for me, as a challenge as a first yep. idea, is like, how is this going to work?
Yeah. You know, yeah, it was really tough. We had long decisions about, oh, because normally you record the music before, you have the music before, and then yeah. you sync it in post, and you lip sync it, and it's just a playback. Okay. But what was enormously satisfying with shooting Up to Camp and all the live music there was actually live shot with actually one camera, which is enormously difficult, but also gives a lot of credit to the editor who managed to cut that together. Okay. Between different takes. Without compromising the music, but the choice of doing that it, for once it feels so real. You can watch the biggest American productions, you can still feel, huh, they didn't do that live, but we did it live, and that's about the resonance of the room, it's about the technique, that's about how it should sound. I mean, at least how it should sound in my ears, and live is live, you know.
That leads me to this: what draws you to a project, and do you have a criteria for choosing a project?
For me, the projects that I've are close to my heart, they're always about, obviously, characters in some sort of gray zone, in a specific time, in a specific society. I think the political element, even though it's not on the nose, is always there, whether it's a thriller or a drama or even something more light or a comedy. I'm trying, at least, to have that resonate, so you have some sort of, there's something else going on as well around you. Some sort of sense of humor, even though it's very obscure and or dark or bizarre or not even noticeable, is important. Also, reading a script, or reading a book, or getting an idea, but especially if you read scripts or books, if you get images in your head, it doesn't have to be actors. Actually, actors for me come very late. They are part of a process. But the characters, they pop up, and I'm interested about them. And it's something that resonates within. Because I like ensemble pieces, as you know. That hasn't been really always a choice. I would love to do something more, you know, condensed and small, obviously. Mm. But the script that I have, or the stories that has resonated a lot in my heart are driven by a lot of characters. Even though one or two are maybe main characters, I think it's very important. For me, ensemble is very important, and also. Obviously, living in Sweden and being born in the 70s, I don't know why, but I've been very interested in that period. 60s, 70s, as you know, we've worked on a couple of them, but also 80s and 90s. So you follow you follow yourself in a way, and you rediscover the world that you lived in through a TV series or cinema. I mean, Lasse Mannen was very close to me because I was living that period. That was the 90s. Maybe late 80s, but also early 90s especially, and what happened in society then in Stockholm in particularly, but also in Sweden. So it's always a lot of my projects come back to it's a story about Sweden. Even though, you know, it's like a, yeah, with Utticamp, with Lasseman, with Call Girl, with Gentlemen and Gangsters, definitely with Jakten på en mördare. Historical events are also obviously a big thing. I have no, you know, interest in doing documentaries, but I'm very interested how documentaries or real events could blend into fiction.
If I look at it, and I don't know if this is a correct phrase, or excuse me some of the things that even when working with you and seeing them later, it's almost as if it's this whole subjective objective situation, but yep. in your films, there seems to be both.
Yeah, not just being influenced by cinema, but also being influenced by life, basically, observing. Mm-hmm. I like very much the coldness sometimes of observing a scene when you don't shove, feelings and emotions down the throat of an audience, but when they have to make a choice of their own, and maybe feel a bit, you know, disturbed sometimes, not being giving a certain answer about a character, about a situation, and having to make your own choice as an audience, or have to be like making a choice, basically, you know. Mm. But also pointing their eyes in a certain direction, letting them think that they're doing that by themselves. So I think it's a lot of my series and films contain a lot of that. You know, on one side, on the one hand, you have a camera that's very subjective, very moving, very, you know, you can almost go back, you can go back to Hitchcock, you can go back to Scorsese, or you can go back to Bogdan, or whatever. And then you can have those other scenes that are more like, okay, what's going on there? It's like almost documentary. I think it's a visual medium as well, so I think we tend sometimes to forget that it is a visual medium that could be really used, and it's just not actors talking and being like filmed. It's also, for me, film and TV, modern TV at least, so much about so much more. It's very cinematic as well, and I think both actors, story obviously, characters, but also sets and rooms, environments, together with sound and music, they create the whole world. So sometimes I think that there's so much, you could go so much, you could be very creative within those. You don't have to be locked into just, you know, basically filming two people talking. Mm-hmm.
Your attention to detail is impeccable. You have both the visual details, which are reflections of the times, oftentimes the reflection of the times the story takes place in. How important is research to you, and how important is it to get it right, exactly right?
If you deal with matters that have some sort of, that reflects some sort of reality or history that has actually happened, and that could be very fictionalized, but within the times, doing Lasseman or doing Call Girl or doing Utticamp or all these different things, you have to be there. And I think even though it's very difficult to get all the details right, you have to at least get enough of them as real as possible, so you can also forget about them and be there with the character. So it's just not an actor sitting there with 70s clothes and a wig.
Andrew hade sprungit i kvarteret sedan barnsben, så han kände varenda människa. Där fanns affärer med allt utom kunder. Och varje dag var det lunch, på Kostas.
Vem står han nu då?
Hej Henry, välkomna!
Hej, tjena Kost. Vi tar två öl med en gång.
Det är Kostas.
Såklart, jag känner efter en etta.
Det här skulle kunna vara rad, va?
Vad är det för käk idag då?
I don't think you have to overdo it. That's also how you shoot things. Sometimes we've made choices to shoot something that we've dressed very, very meticulously, but we shoot it in a sloppy way. So it feels like, okay, this doesn't really matter, but everything is there. But also, I think research for me is very much getting into a project, whether that would be based on a true story or not based on a true story, or some kind of historical event. It's a way for me in getting in, and it's a way of me in getting prepared, working with crew and actors. It's a way of me to be, in the end of it, if I've done my research right, I can offer so much to the actors, and that comes into costume, makeup, hair, but also props, what they use in a scene, how they feel that they're there, how they can really go into their their characters and be free. I mean, like, you know, we tend to, especially when we do period, dress up rooms with stills connected to every scene and inspiration pictures that is very useful for everybody, not only for art department, but for costume, for makeup, for actors actually going into those rooms and looking, okay, this is where we should go. But good preparation, a lot of talk, and trying to find something, actually find the people that share your taste. You come a long way with that. The few times I've went against that or being forced not to work with people that I obviously maybe would have chosen instead of others, it has come to in my eyes compromises that are not always great. But if you have the luxury of and having all the stars aligned there with crew and actors and everything, it can be a real joy. It's not as easy as just let's put the best together on the list and they should work together. It doesn't really work like that, you know. I would love it to, but it doesn't. Yeah, so you have to also choose, be very meticulous about how you put together a crew.
Choosing a crew, do you choose them based on what's right for the project artistically? We went into a little bit of that.
Yeah.
But also, or from a personal relationship standpoint, or do both sides weigh into your decision?
Yeah, you need good people. You need professional people. We also need people that has a good, you know, sense of humor, a good work ethics, and also flexibility. And then there's always the realism of things. There's a schedule to keep. There's a budget to try to keep. There's always those restraints of, you know, making a shooting day work, as you well known as first AD as well. So you really need your gang there, and you need to have fun with them as well, even though there's sometimes conflicts or not. But the ground respect needs to be there, and the ground love needs to be there. Same thing with actors. Very difficult to work with actors that you actually don't resonate with. And it's the same thing with post, actually. We're doing a lot of work with Per, for example, who's mixing now. My latest show for SVT is called Händelse vid vatten. We've been working for years, you know, developing an idea how to do the sound, how to work, what we like, what we don't like, what we could improve, what we can do different to offer something new. That takes time, you know. You have to also give people a chance to develop together as much as you yourself like to have been given chances to be better and better as a director. You have to give other people's, you have to together with other crew members get better and better and deeper. And I think you get better and better into working together. And if it's a good collaboration, you know, the next one would be, you can build from there and from there and from there. Same thing with actors. So I think personality and being professionals are obviously very important. Also editing, for example, spent last almost 20 years with the same guy in a room. We've never had a fight, it's incredible. But still good arguments and how do you, I mean, if he would have been an asshole, it would never have worked, or maybe me, but we actually click together and it works, and we try to do different things all the time. To have a mutual respect for each other's taste into what you're doing, you know, and just giving everything to what should be shown there on the television or the screen, and not being protective and not being, you know, care too much about yourself, but care much more about what's going to be up there. I have a feeling for what I want to get through and how I want things to look. Again, I can't do that on my own. I need a good DOP to guide me, but also to test my ideas against. And like everything else in the filmmaking process, I think that's important. I think it's something you should require from a director to know, because why do you do film? Why do you do television? It's a visual medium, so. Theater is one thing, but film, you have to know, you know, it's like a painter, he has to know what kind of canvas he wants to use, you know, what colors, but you have to know, even though you're not a DP on yourself, you have to know a little bit about lensing, a little bit about camera movements, about the feeling, and that's something you learn through the years, or have some sort of natural talent for, or feel for, I don't know, but again, you're not alone, you need a very good DOP, you need to have also a guy who can take your involvement, who's not precious, who can have discussion and think it's fun, and also, like, for me, every day, we're talking earlier about, you know, when we're out there eating, every day is different, but also every day should be contain a certain amount of fun or satisfying shots, or, you know, the feeling that you grow together, to build something together. And sometimes some days are good, some days are bad, but you need people who can hang on in there with you for a long period, since we're shooting often for quite long periods. I would also say, in terms of DOP, that gaffer is very important because film and TV is light. Light is everything for me. And light can just be as important as an actor's performance sometimes. What you see, what not to see, the depth of the shot, the darkness or the brightness or whatever, you know.
How important is the DOP, the director of photography role, and the director's role? Like, how important is that?
Again, about getting to know each other. If you click together, for Hoyt and myself, we met when we did La Semana, and it was a big turning point for me in terms of how to understand how to get my vision through a DOP and how a DOP could support that vision and also teach me something, you know. So I think we had a very good collaboration there in terms of what he knew wanted to go. We're also starting up a bit, both of us. So,
do you need to describe that process with Hoyta? You know, just how did you get? What were some concrete things that you did?
Well, starting by just you know, hanging out, eating, drinking, and watching stuff that we liked, sharing stuff that we've done, some stuff we liked about each other, some we didn't. You know, what to do next together. Technique, a lot of technique. You know, very, you know, I think Hoyta, I think, is very, he's very technical, but he's also very, has a lot of,
intuitive.
Yeah, intuitive. So, and also his eye, his precision to details, and also a way of catching the actor in the camera and the actor's actually liking it, not being disturbed by the technical side too much.
Your work with production designers,
yeah,
and how important that is. That goes again with
the
attention to detail.
Yeah, it has to do with the attention of detail. It has to do with the subject matter, obviously. Gentlemen and Gangsters. We worked with Linda Jansson, who had a very specific eye and a very, you know, whose taste I really loved, and she understood it, and she brought so much into it together with her crew. I have to say, there's so many people around her, but they had so good taste, I think, and so serious about their work. And like I said, that goes into what it can give to not only just the satisfaction of making a period room look correct. It's also about how the actors feel in that room, how the camera perceives it, and what it tells. So that's why I tend to call the room or the space or the stage or the location, that's a character as well, as much as the actors. They have to respond to it.
When we talk about casting, what is it that's important? What do you think about when casting?
It comes so differently. Sometimes you just know that's the guy, or that's the girl, or that's the woman, or that's the man. But sometimes you go through a lot of people and you make choices, and sometimes it's very difficult because if you take that certain character, okay, you'll go that direction. There's no truth in it. There's no one way or the. There's not a right answer except for yourself. So you have to find your own right answer. Who do you want this person to be in your series or your film? And it's not only about looks, it's also about, for me, very much about energy, the sound of a voice, how free they are in their bodies. Body language is a big thing. When you have one actor, is one thing. When you have two or three actors, they start responding to each other. So everything is flexible. Nothing is. That goes into the casting process very much. We try to. When I worked with casting so far, trying to, if it's important, to get people that are going to play together also during a casting process, just to understand how they play off each other. I did on my last project, we had to shoot this commune in the early 70s for Blackwater, the Händelse vid vatten that we're doing right now. And we had actually days of rehearsals, mm-hmm. You can call it rehearsals, but we're actually sitting around a table eating, basically, in my cabin up north, and just talking about, yeah, the script, about life, about differences, about acting, about art, about music, and slowly getting to maybe reading some scenes, and not maybe rehearsing, but, you know, touch. And we did that in Uptecamp as well, you know, we gather the actors. I think that's a very important thing that comes after casting. But casting, obviously, when you make a decision about who's going to play a certain part, it's very intuitive, and you have to, if you make at least for yourself, the right decision, then the journey is going to be very smooth. I'm very afraid in the beginning of casting just to make the wrong decision and just not to. That's why I hate, like, okay, let's take that one and that one because they're known. And sometimes that has nothing to do with your process, creative process. It's more about financing or you know, trying to get a project. When you put up a lot of names, known actors, and oh, it could be like this or like that, but that's, for me, the complete wrong way to start. It starts with the story, and then, you know, in an ideal world, you would love to, you know, try out actors, known or unknown, doesn't really matter, but who's good for that, and who do you connect to? Who do you think would work with that actor? How would they interact? I have very much difficulties in if I would just start to cast one actor, and then one actor, and one. I have to see some sort of, so I tend to do, together with the casting director, maps. Even before making the final decision, we do maps, visual maps of the actors, even though they haven't done any screen tests or anything. But just to get a feel about what does the ensemble look like, how does this piece work together? It's like a canvas, with some red there, some blue, some green, how do I mix those? Before making the final decisions. The first one we worked together on was Up the Camp, and there we have four main characters. And you remember how much tests we did, you know, before deciding, before giving, we didn't give one of the actors a role before the other, we gave them all a role when we knew. So you remember all these, we did, and that one was really particular, we did a lot of screen tests, we did a lot of interviews, we did also a lot of actual, you know, test filming in costume and makeup before we actually made a final decision. So that was really, you know, going into it and trying to use that in all my project as much as you can when you can within the budget, or when you can have that luxury of doing that during the casting period. My process would be in ideal pre-production to give the actors a lot of time to try out clothes, try out costume, try props, sit down together, talk. Don't need to rehearse a scene till it's finished. That's actually a thing I learned. I did during Up the Camp. We did one scene that we rehearsed too much. We went too far with two of the characters, and the day before shooting, we rehearsed, and it was so good. I remember I took pictures. I don't know if I taped it. I don't know if you've left at that point, but it was a scene that was supposed to take place between Sverre and Ruth, I think, in the house in the 70s, and they did such a great rehearsal. So the next day when we came to shoot it, it was a disaster. I couldn't, you know, it was never as good. So you have to learn, and that was a big lesson for, and I mean, I had to reshoot it even, you know, I reshot that scene and try to squeeze it into the schedule, and we did reshoot it, and it was okay. But we had to forget about that rehearsal because we went too far into deciding things, into being too perfect. So you have to also, that's about being a bit cool and letting it loose, and also to let the actors keep a secret and keep something for the actual day of the shooting. That's why rehearsal is good, but you have to be a bit careful how you approach rehearsing and how finished you are, because it can also kill what's supposed to be in front of the camera before you're even there. And I've talked to both experienced and inexperienced actors, and for an interesting thing is, like, sometimes you don't need 75 shots to get it right. Sometimes you need one. Hopefully too, in case something happens in editing. But so there's no one way to go, you know? And if you're lucky and everything is there, and sometimes that pressure of having, like, oh, I got one take, maybe two before the sun goes down and before we have to break, that pressure, that energy that comes out of that can also be very useful for an actor, for a director, DOP, or everybody, but also for actors, even though they don't like it in the moment, but it will give something, and hopefully it will give something that is interesting as well. So, yeah.
How important is trust between you and the actor?
Oh, that's everything. If you don't have that, you don't have anything, basically. And I think it becomes mechanical. So you have to impress yourselves during every workday, trying to push the boundary, push the limits of what a thing is, and try different things. But every actor is different, and every director is probably different as well. But so you have to find your own methods with each and every actor. What do they respond to? What do they need to understand the scene? But also doing, for example, Jakten, I don't know if you remember, we had a very important scene that we came up with during writing process quite late. That was in the script in a way, but wasn't really developed with one of the police officers, Lotten, I think it was, and the serial killer. And I don't know if you remember, there was this thing that we came up with, maybe it was a day or two before, and it was like, oh my God, this is a lot of dialogue, and we have like maybe 15 extra minutes to do that. And when I see the final result, it's like, there's no way that couldn't have been in there. But then we had gone through all this preparing work with showing the sets, showing the costume, test filming, you know, lensing and stuff, talking a lot with real people, doing our research. So when it got to that point, it was like the actors really did an amazing job into like basically learning a whole new scene with a lot of dialogue, almost on the day. And it was a tough day, but it did work, and it brought something fantastic. So I have to be also very careful not to get, I think, too comfortable within a long shooting period. So sometimes, for the good of the project, obviously, but sometimes you need to really catch those moments when you have a gut feeling that something is missing or that you need something there for the story, for the final product. Hate calling it a product, but I want to call it art, but maybe that's too pretentious. But for the final, you know, series or film, you need to force yourselves to be a bit uncomfortable sometimes with things just to get there, not to be lazy or sloppy about it. Or I mean, the most difficult thing is not to actually, if we're shooting for 60 days or 100 days or 110 days, after 3-4 weeks, you know, everybody's hunky dory in the crew and everything's goes well and it's just a smooth ride, then you also have to be very careful about not forgetting about what's in front of the camera, because everything is so cool around it. And also when you have a nice, like we often do, crew, great actors that you know, I mean, it's easy to just, oh fuck, this is great, you know, we're the circus, you know, and that's it. But we need to think about what we also come back with, what we need to bring to the edit room. So it's good from time to time to wake yourself up and to give yourself some obstacles and problems that you have to solve just to get the focus back on.
Yeah, I mean, not to get complacent, yeah. And not to just rest.
And because then it becomes just collecting shots after a while, which is the most boring thing to do.
Soft prep, hard prep, day before shooting. Mm-hmm. What's your process there?
Soft prep, getting the script, I guess, reading it, getting, you know, starting to expand your vision about the script to also connect the dots between that script, your own inner self, influences, references, you know, research, basically. Then bringing that into a very concrete world with people that you have to sit in a room, like we do also a lot. We sit in a room, we have a reading, not for the actors, but for the crew. Everybody would be there. Even, you know, light, DOP, gaffer sometimes, grip, you know, it could be sound, it should be basically a production, obviously, costume, makeup, planning, first AD, everything. So sitting there and really going through, I think we did that with Gentlemen and Guys, so we had this long 2 days of just reading, and that was just excluded from all the other research, was just going through, preparing for that meeting, going through it scene by scene. I think we did it on Jakten as well. We just took scene by scene, what's the vision here, without going too much into details, but still making the point come across. What is this scene? What should it tell? What do we see? Also, that's very much connected to scouting. Since in my project we do not so much studio work, sometimes we do, but a lot is location based and building on location. A lot of stills taken during the location scouts. Those stills are referred to both as, okay, this is the room, should we dress it 360 or not? But also sometimes the shots in themselves are the eye of the camera, how you think it is. And sometimes I take those shots, sometimes the DOP takes it, sometimes the production designer take those shots for different reasons. So those we would go through very meticulously as well. And that becomes a groundwork, that becomes a stage for the actors. So that's a good start, I think, in pre-production. During all this, everything goes simultaneously. You have to be everywhere. So you can't really have the choice of doing one thing at a time, but you need to have all those things and have them prepared for the day of shooting. In the best case scenario, as you know, sometimes we've been chasing locations during shoot, which is horrible, but sometimes we had the luxury of having almost every location before the shoot, which also gives you something else. before the first day of shooting, just, oh shit, I'm not ready. very nervous into going to the first day and just have to jump in there and, you know, it's like diving from the highest trampoline to pool, you know, it's like, ah, just do it. You have to. There's nothing to fear but fear itself. But also trusting that you, after all these years, maybe have some sort of, you have some sort of engine that can, some sort of, you know, your experience can help you getting through a first day without, you know, going crazy or. But also preparing for the first day, obviously shot lists. We used to do them, you know, shot by shot. Sometimes it's not often storyboarded. Some parts are storyboarded, but that's most difficult if there's some kind of action or something. But mostly we, as you know, we write down shot lists of what we should do during the day. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, I don't know how many setups per scene, depending on the length of the scene. Those shot lists are describing the scene, but also if it's a close-up, if the camera should move or not, what we need to cover. In certain cases, some important lines that needs to be there in a close-up or not. So it could depend, but I tend to go through for myself and trying to distribute it. And we've been doing it together as well, James. We do it two times, actually. We do it one time breaking down the script when we do the schedule. I think we do some sort of very rough shot list, and we're like, okay, maybe 3 shots, maybe 4 shots. You remember for Jakten?
Yeah.
We sat on that porch in Skåne and counted extras. Has to do a lot with planning, scheduling, and budget, obviously. And then you do one during the whole process of scouting, of course, and then you do it also, yeah, the night before. You kind of boil it down to a shot list, which you show to the first AD and everybody on the morning, or the night before. It's always impossible to make, but we'll try, you know. Yeah.
What is good editing to you?
It's just taste, man. I don't know. What is good editing? Yeah, not shoving down a feeling down an audience's throat, to be very broad. Not to force, I mean, to choose when to do it. But to trust in, to create a tension. How do you do that? How long do you stay on a close up? When do you cut to a long shot? When do you choose to just have a scene that is one long take? Is the camera moving? Is not moving? Man, I'm during shoot. I tend to cut a lot in my head, so I have an idea about, okay, this is probably how it's going to look, and sometimes it actually does look like that. Sometimes. The editor I'm used to work with, he comes in now. We have a process of him coming in during the shoot as well, pre-editing a bit. We're not getting locked into anything. It's just a way of him getting into the project as well. So I invite him to the set, wherever we are, and he do, you know, some sort of quick cut. But often we've also been talking so much about it before, the editor and I, before he even comes in. I also bring him in script stage before we shot a single frame, so he would know, and we've talked about things, so we would know where we want to go more or less. But then the process of it being editing something a little bit during shoot, but then, and quite close after the shoot, not taking too much time off, I don't do that, but then going into the edit room, and then upon that day, my editor would have, or Christopher would have probably assembled enough material for, I don't know, a sequence or an episode or something, so we can go through. And he's very meticulous as well in trying to find what he feels is the best takes, the best shot, the best pauses. So we have a nice workflow there. And then I would come in and we would talk, go back to each scene individually, look at shots again, look at takes again. And make our choices.
Do you have an example of good editing? It doesn't have to be from your films, but
depends on what you're looking at. I mean, I love some of Scorsese's films. I think they're so how he throws himself into, as an audience, you're thrown into a situation. The start of Goodfellas, for example. Boom! You're just on a street somewhere outside of New York, and somebody's hitting the back of the car, and you know what the fuck's going on. And then you cut the. I mean, it's very. Very cinematic in a way. Also the way he cuts, and also have some scenes that are very much edited, and other scenes that actually are long takes. But it could also be very classic work. There's a film that I love, it's from Peter Bogdanovich, it's called Last Picture Show. Very simple, very like classic, and it's also like, wow, everything is there within the shot. The camera doesn't move too much, but how he placed them within the shot and the scenery, and it's fantastic. It's like I was mentioning, sometimes you don't want to just show everything. You want also to have certain shots that the audience would almost not understand because you wake them up. But if you're making a series of 6 hours, of course, if you just go on in the same pace, and I mean, if you understand everything, you know, while you're watching, you have to keep a mystery. That's how you keep somebody interested in watching. So sometimes that would go into editing as well. Okay, now we need to have a shot of an eel in a bucket for half a second, but what was that? And then you come back to, will I see it again or not, you know? And sometimes you just need to rest on a situation long enough to make, I mean, first it's interesting, then it's boring, then it becomes really interesting. So, yeah. So much intuitive and what you want the scene to be like or perceived, or what you hoped the scene to be perceived, you know?
And how much do you cut the temp track that Matthias has done, or is there any sort of...
It's been different. In Opticamp, I think we had so much music before, so we cut almost just to source and temp track. Songs that we wanted to choose and temp track from Matthias. It was the same, I think, with Call Girl and with Gentleman. It was so prepared. With Jakten, it was very difficult because on that one, Hunt for Murder, the subject matter was so difficult for us all, you know? It was so, it had to be so dry and matter of fact and not, you know, couldn't be cool or action driven or wow, you know, you had to be really respectful to the subject matter. And that was difficult for us all, I think, both in editing, shooting, making the music was in a way horrible because what can you do? When does it becomes cheesy? When does this becomes like intentional or too, you know, exploiting. So then the music came very late, you know, and we had to try things out, and finally, okay, this is where we're going now.
Do you think directors have an ethical and moral responsibility to the audience?
Yes, definitely. I think first of all, I have a responsibility, moral and ethical responsibility towards myself. Because I'm also the audience of what I'm doing, so I have to start there and find that one and try to... That came very much into when we did Hunt for a Killer and Call Girl and obviously Laser Man. That was also very much inspired by true events. So when you go into those kind of stories, you have to be a bit... you have to be careful of how you use those tools. Even though I think sometimes we should be able to maybe have a little bit more artistic freedom. Sometimes I think we tend to put too much into fictional work, that fictional work would actually be the reality. It's not the reality, even though documentaries are not the reality, you know, when you shoot documentaries. So sometimes you tend to put too much importance into that. But definitely it starts with your own choice of the project and what you want to. There's something you want to get through there. I don't think you should tell the audience every time what you actually think, but I think you need to know what you're thinking and what you want people to reflect upon after seeing the film.
How much of yourself are in your films?
Certain series and films are more what I loved as a filmmaker or being wanting to be a filmmaker. Films that inspire me, for example. Graven, the grave first, it was 8 hours, weird thriller. That was maybe very much me, but maybe not on a personal level, but it was a great story and interesting, weird characters and something new within the genre of crime in Sweden. This is before all this, what do you call it? Swedish noir or what is it? Nordic noir. Something, a concept that I really dislike saying now, but it was before that and it was very successful. But in there we put so much energy into. It was a love letter also to cinema. To I think in that particular it was a lot of 70s things coming in there in terms of lighting, in terms of design of clothes. Even though it was modern times, and I think we watched Jaws 10,000 times because the investigation took place on a boat and it was supposed to be just. Everything was weird, but it was a great fun and I learned a lot. That was my best film school, actually, making that as a quite young director, making 8 hours thriller, you know, one story with actually quite heavy actors from big theaters and also from other movies, very known actors and very big ensemble and a lot of locations and a long shoot. It was a shoot over 110, 120 days, and that was my I had done shorter shoots before, but that was the big one, right, that also resonated with the audience. And I've loved a lot of projects that I've done, but I have to say, since then, putting more on myself, Laser Man, obviously, I grew up during that period, so there was a lot of me in there in terms of what I feared, and also a lot of what I had, you know, seen around me in the society. Maybe not so much private, other than fear, but also what reflecting about the political movements there, the extreme right that growed and was really scary at that time, and as it is now. Upp till kamp was very much, set during a period that I actually was too young as a kid, or not even born, but then also the early 70s, which I did have some sort of conception of. And there's always going to be, in directing actors and in choices of things and tastes, something you bring from yourself, whether it's conscious or unconscious, I think. And I think you should have, I think it's great to have something, I don't know what it is all the times, but sometimes people say, oh, I saw this and I'm sure it was you, and sometimes they're right, and then it's good, okay, there was something in there that they saw that was me as a director, as a mark, you know.
Some of your influences.
Yeah, apart from life and living, you mean?
Filmmakers,
yeah. Well, starts obviously with the obvious. I mean, I went to film history classes, so I studied the history of cinema. So there's a lot that I love. It's like music. I don't like one thing. I like a lot of things. But the French New Wave obviously was hit me very hard, as well as the Italian neorealism and post-realism of that. Obviously, the golden age of Hollywood, late 60s and early 70s, and all the 70s into the early 80s, that's been like what we grew up on, basically, and what we understood was good cinema. French Connection, Jaws, you know, Taxi Driver, Raging Bull, all that jazz, Peter Bogdanovich, Last Picture Show, those kind of films. Apocalypse, you know, Godfather, you have it. What we saw on VHS when we were kids, basically, was out there, and what we could sneak into cinema. You know? So it was. I just was like a sponge. I just absorbed as much as I could from. And this is also the times before the VHS when you went to the cinema and you watched it. It could be James Bond, or it could be, I don't know, a Borman film, like, you know, Deliverance. You know, oh, what's this? You know, it's weird. So there's so much that you see, and you consciously or unconsciously grab, and that's also a film school in a way, before you find some of your own tools that you like to develop. But obviously, I think you're inspired by things. It's like going to school.
Film versus digital.
Oh, any day film if I could choose. But we're in a world now that doesn't really accept film anymore. I think it's really terrifying, because it's like. It's like renouncing from a tool that is and has been fantastic if you can manage it. I don't really have anything against digital. I think you can also do it extremely. You can do a lot with digital. It's great, but I think it's a shame that we. I mean, certain people are still fighting for it a lot. I'm one of them. I don't have the luxury to do everything on film, but certainly all my commercials and some of my TV series and films I've shot on film. 16 or 35, so it would always be a preference in terms of texture and nuances. Obviously, you can achieve a lot of that with a new technique, and with if you're careful with lensing, and also with the LUTs, as you call them. I like very much to what I like with film is that you make a choice before, so you have to expose. You have a certain feel of texture of the skin tones and everything. Of course, you can adjust them, like as well as digital. But I remember when we started digital, and I remember getting rushes back from digital before you have LUTs and stuff, and it came in and it just looked like a piece of, I don't know what, it was just flat and boring, and it was nothing there. And to sit and cut on this soulless material that you've seen for your eye, you know, how it could look, or through a lens of a camera. And so I think it got better when you started to make those decisions, even though you can change them digitally. So when we had, for the three, now we did digitally on the last project we did Jakten, for example, where we made sure that it looked like as much as 16 or 35 as we could, and that was also depending on lenses and LUTs and to decide something before, so when you're actually sitting in the edit, everybody, producers and distributors, everybody can see something that is actually quite beautiful, even though it's not ready. But I would say film over digital any time of the day. And I don't think it's an excuse that it's cheaper nowadays. I think the difference is, if you planned well, it's not huge. And you can make a decision about how to do it if you can plan it. Obviously, if you cannot plan shit, if you need to shoot 360 all the time and just roll and roll and roll and take millions of takes, yes, digital is a good tool. But if you have some kind of idea, I come from film as a assistant director, when you couldn't just shoot tons and tons and tons of film, you were restricted to that. And I think that restriction also is good for you when you think about the project before, you know, the visuals and your vision. So if you're well prepared, I would definitely say film, because it's so satisfactory. I have to say, yeah. I mean, when I shoot digital, I wanted to shoot it like I was shooting film. So there's a very clear action, there's a very clear cut, there's a very clear beginning and an end. So we try to keep the discipline also for the day, for making the day. We try to keep the discipline of shooting like we shot on film. So there's no, for me, so far, hasn't been any need to take 175 takes of one single, because I think the work should be done. This is my work ethics, doesn't have to share with anybody else. It doesn't have to be the right ones, but for me, you know, if you've done your home lesson, if you have taken your time and think about what you want to do and what you want to put out there, of course you should give the actors chances to do different takes. That's not a problem. We could do sometimes 15 takes, you know, or which I think is quite a lot. But sometimes you don't need more than 5 takes, because the actor is prepared, because the actor has something to give in the first 2-3 ones. That, and I'm not really sure that, at least in my worth ethics, I don't need to break down people by, you know, overshooting them or anything. I think there's other ways of reaching those performances.
One piece of advice for aspiring directors in today's.
Ooh. Do your homework, be prepared, work hard on the script, try to have a clear vision and try to express that vision however you do that. Be very meticulous who you work with and try to listen to people also. Try to find your own band, you know, your own group. That can support you, because it's difficult to make film and you cannot be on your own and you cannot get all the ideas by yourself. You need to be open to ideas, you need to be humble, but you also need to be strong and depending on how long you shoot, try to stay as healthy as you can.
One question for Sanna Lincoln.
What makes you want to do a certain project? It's so large. And the other question would be, how do you stay with that project and keep it alive for yourself from beginning of the process, starting with the script and without the script, going to all the process of shooting, casting, or everything we talked about, and then to deliver something at the end that is your final piece. How to keep the energy up through the whole process.
And if you could describe directing in one word, what would that be?
Stubbornness.
On that, we say thank you.
Thank you.